Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening. Thank you for downloading. And thank you for subscribing to the latest edition of the 12 Kyle podcast. I am 12 Kyle. Check this out. On this episode, we're going back. We're going back to February 6th, 2003. On that day, 50 Cent released his debut album, Get Rich or Die Tryin'. And we're going to talk about it. We're going to talk about the album. We're going to talk about 50 Cent and his rise, the track listing, the production, everything. It's hard. It is literally hard to believe that this album is turning 20 years old. I distinctly remember this album and its drop for a number of reasons, and I'll get into it in just a second. But yeah, man, it's been 50 Cent since, it's been 20 years since 50 Cent hit the scene. And I'll be honest, it doesn't feel like it's been that long, at least to me. You know, at the time of this recording, I don't even think 50 Cent is even making music. He's, you know, into making movies and he's got TV shows and all of this stuff like that. But, you know, once upon a time, kids, 50 Cent was a, you know, pretty popular rapper. So let's go back. February 6th, 2003. One of the things that I remember about this time was there was a shift. You know, rap has gone through a lot of shifts. There was a shift in hip hop. There was a shift in how we actually consumed hip hop. At this particular time, one of the things that was very popular was the ability to get music for free. bootlegging was running rampant. Well, bootlegging has always been a part of hip hop, but at this particular time in early 2003, you know, the cost of CDs were going up and music was so abundant that, you know, people really wanted to get their hands on the music, especially if the music was hot, especially if the music was something that, you know, you normally wouldn't pay for or whatever the case may be. You know, so people wanted, they had to have it. So it was something where they were going to do whatever it took to get to the music. That being said, 50 Cent was a very, very popular, I don't want to call him underground, but he wasn't mainstream just yet. Like he was very popular in the mixtape scene. And he was one of the most popular mixtape artists at the time. He did not have a studio album. And I'm sure all of you are familiar with the story. For those who aren't, 50 Cent was, you know, somewhat of a troublemaker, if you will. He'd been in and out of jail, you know, a couple of times with run-ins with the law. But the word was that this was the guy that had gotten shot 9 times and lived to tell about it. And honestly, that made 50 Cent's legend. Not saying he was a legend, but that made his legend that much bigger. Because you normally don't get shot 9 times and still live. But he became like somewhat of a legend in the streets. And keep in mind, at this particular time in 2003, the internet, while the internet was out, it was something that it wasn't as prevalent as it is today. Like, I had the internet in my house, but I had like dial up. I had like AOL Messenger. Like, it was, and the internet was in its early infancy stages of where it would be. So while I would get online and I could download music for free, well, not for free, illegally, I should say, through sites like Kazaa and LimeWire and stuff like that. You know, I wanted to hear what this guy, who this guy was. And I remember listening to a song. It was on a mixtape. I think it was a Clue mixtape. A song called Ghetto Quran. And in the song Ghetto Quran, 50 Cent makes accusations that Kenneth Supreme, what's Supreme's last? I can't remember Supreme's last. Griffin. Supreme was legendary founder of the drug consortium, the Supreme Team. In fact, there's a really dope documentary on the Supreme Team on Showtime. If you have Showtime, go check that out or find it online. But nonetheless, he made a reference to Supreme being responsible to somewhat about someone being killed in New York. Supreme and 50 are from the same place, Jamaica, Queens. And so subsequently, allegedly, Supreme sent some people at 50 and they got him. But thing about it was 50 got shot 9 times, including in the jaw, I think, and he lived to tell about it. And so word was that 50 was this guy who had a record deal or was getting record deals, but once he got shot, industry people backed away from him, all except for Eminem and Dr. Dre. Eminem found 50, brought him to Dr. Dre, and they said, hey, we're going to produce this kid, we're going to look out for him, whatever, whatever. And the rest was quote unquote history. So I said all that to say this: the legend of 50 Cent was big before his album even dropped. So, you know how, like, a lot of times you can tell people, oh man, well, this guy's hot or this chick is hot, and their music doesn't match. Well, 50 Cent had an aura and he had a rep, not necessarily being somebody tough, but he was a street guy who was now rapping, and he was mythical to some degree. And so I wanted to give that context as to who 50 Cent was, and you'll kind of understand the popularity and why this album was what it was. So then we fast forward into February, and by this time 50 is burning up. He's burning up the mixtape scene with the song Wanksta. And 50 had beef with, at the time, arguably one of the most popular hip hop artists at that particular time, and that was Ja Rule. Ja Rule, who also is from Jamaica, Queens, who's also down with Supreme, or was down with Supreme at the time. Ja Rule and 50 had beef. Ja Rule and 50 actually had gotten into a physical fist fight in a studio. The two dudes don't like each other. So 50 came up with the term wankster, you know, fake gangster, whatever like that, about Ja Rule. And so here it was, 50 not only had the Ghetto Quran song, he had Wankster, and he also made a song called How to Rob. And that was probably the first time that I heard 50. It was on a mixtape. And How to Rob featured 50 rapping about how he would rob other rappers in the industry. Now, as you can hear in How to Rob, 50 was, he's being facetious. He's not, you know, really talking about robbing people or robbing these, you know, celebrities or rappers or whatever like that. But that song pissed a lot of people off because it's like, okay, wait a minute. You just got here. You ain't even here yet. And you're making waves like this. So suffice to say, 50 pissed a lot of people off before the first album even comes out. So all of that is the backdrop to Get Rich or Die Trying. So February 6, 2003, this album actually was supposed to come out, I think, like 2 weeks later. But because the album was so heavily bootlegged, they moved it up to February 6th, right? And I won't forget it. I'll never forget it because that album came out the same weekend. And I want to say, if I'm not mistaken, without looking at a calendar, I think February 6th was a Friday. Albums normally dropped on Tuesdays, but they moved it to a Friday in advance of the following Tuesday, in which it was supposed to drop. And they did that because, again, it was being bootlegged like crazy. But that particular weekend was the same weekend that we had the All-Star game in my hometown, my adopted hometown of Atlanta, Georgia. So 2003 All-Star game. It is the last All-Star game that Michael Jeffrey Jordan, the GOAT would participate in. Just a little side story. So the whole hip hop world has converged, and the whole basketball world has converged on Atlanta GA. And when I tell you, and I was out that weekend, I was outside that weekend. I distinctly remember taking our oldest son, Dion, to an event at downtown near the arena. And we took the train because traffic was bananas. Like, you couldn't go anywhere in traffic. And so the thing that I remember about that weekend was, even when I was in the car or just walking around, every place you went, you heard this album. You heard it in the club. You heard it in cars passing by. You heard it on the radio. I mean, like, they were, everybody was, this was an album that, honestly, if you did not get it that weekend and the store sold out, because that was something that did happen, you might have gone a week or two without getting that album, unless you could find it on bootleg. And one of the things that was huge about this album was that it was being produced by the legendary Dr. Dre. And so you have all of these things. Eminem is a hot rapper, and Eminem is one of the top rappers in the game, and he's bringing this guy as his protege, and he's being mentored by the great Dr. Dre. Dr. Dre executive produced the album. And we are getting production from Dr. Dre. And the word was that, and I don't know how true it was, but the word was that we all know that Dr. Dre was supposed to produce this album called Detox. It was supposed to be his follow-up to The Chronic. Well, Detox never came. And these beats that Dr. Dre had for Detox, which he never released, allegedly were on this album. And so the streets were buzzing. Everybody was going crazy trying to get their hands on this album. And I distinctly remember going to the record store, because, yeah, kids, you had to actually get in your car, drive to the record store to purchase your album. I got to the record store, and I got there early, but it was already a line, and, like, even more people were coming. So everybody that I know, and I kid you not, everybody that I know had that album. You had to have that album. We went to a couple of all-star events. And even in the arena, they were playing 50. So it wasn't, and I think In the Club was the single that he had out. The single dropped in January, the album dropped in February. But yeah, he was everywhere, right? So again, that's the backdrop. The album comes out February 6, 2003. The album's 53 minutes. And it's got producers from everybody, from Dr. Dre, Sha Money XL, Sean Blaze, Dirty Swift, DJ Rad, Terrence Dudley, Mike Elizondo, Megahertz, Mr. Porter, Red Spider, Reef, Rock Wilder, and many others. Again, it was executive produced by Dr. Dre and Eminem. The singles that he released was In the Club. That was released January 7th, 2003, 21 Questions, which also had a video. In the Club had a video as well. I'm pretty sure you guys know that. 21 Questions, March 4th, 2003. Many Men, Wish Death, May 24th, 2003. PIMP, August 12th, 2003. And If I Can't, September 16th, 2003. What can I say, man? This album went through the roof. Again, it was everywhere, so you couldn't go anywhere without hearing the album. This album sold 872,000 physical copies, meaning you had to go out of your house and purchase this album. Physical copies were sold. 872,000. That had never been done in the history of hip hop. And again, they had to move the release date up. So if it wasn't for the fear of it being bootlegged and they didn't have to move it up, there's no telling how many. I mean, this album could have possibly sold 1 million its first week out, which would have been unprecedented. It had not happened before. But 50 was there. I mean, like 50, he had a buzz like crazy. And the fact that he had already pissed off a lot of rappers in the industry, but he had a target, if you will, at Ja Rule, who was, again, the hottest rapper in the game. I mean, just imagine somebody creating in today's time. Imagine somebody creating a buzz via mixtapes. They only have a couple of songs out. They diss the entire rap industry and then jokingly diss the rap industry about talking about how to rob them. And then, you know, they take aim at Drake on their first album and they diss the hell out of Drake. And, you know, that's what it was with 50 and Ja Rule. And I'll talk about Ja Rule and 50 in just a second. But again, you couldn't go anywhere. This album, I think, has sold over 10 million copies, if I'm not mistaken. The reviews were crazy. It was street. It was hood. It was a little bit of everything. He had radio songs. He had club songs. He had, you know, the homie songs. And then he had songs he was just talking shit. And I mean, like, people really took to 50. And, you know, you could say a lot of different reasons as to why, but people really took to 50. And I mean, like, he just had it. I don't know what it is, but 50 had it. And I mean, he won Billboard Awards. He won, got a lot of recognition for the album. And so, you know, 50 does this and, you know, the album is selling through the roof. And again, he has by this time, you know, pissed a few people off, and but he's not caring. And I think that's the thing that really and I misspoke, I'm sorry, he sold 9 million albums. This album sold 9 million albums. But I think by this time, the thing that attracted people to 50 Cent was 50 Cent the rapper didn't care about the fact that some people in the rap industry didn't like him. 50 Cent, the businessman, understood that the fact that people didn't like him made the fans want to hear what he had to say. 50 Cent, the rapper, probably didn't care too much about Ja Rule or Ja Rule's fans, considering the fact that Ja Rule was one of the most popular rap artists at the time. Ja Rule was on everybody's songs. He was on hooks singing and everything. 50 Cent, the businessman, understood that him dissing Ja Rule was going to be a payday for him. And given the fact that they actually physically got into a confrontation, into a fight, that made it even better. 50, I mean, like, so he had no reason but to go in on Ja Rule. And you can make a case, and some have made the case, that 50 Cent's quote unquote verbal assault on Ja Rule ended Ja Rule's music career. Now, I don't know what side you stand on, but the case could be made. And if you really, really look at it and break it down, 50 Cent did everything that he said Ja Rule was doing. All in the videos. 50 was all in the videos. Singing on the hooks. 50 was singing on the hooks. There's no woman singing on any of the hooks on any of these songs on this album. But it's a really, really dope album. So let's get into the track listing. The album opens up with the intro. Coin flip. That is so dope. I mean, I think that's a dope, dope intro. Then he goes into What Up Gangsta. What Up Blood? What Up Cuz? What Up Blood? What Up Gangsta? Now, he ruffles some people's feathers because some people were like, well, no, you're not a gang member, so you can't say that. But it's 50. Again, 50 doesn't care, and he understood that any controversy that he made was going to be beneficial to him financially. And so, like him or love him or hate him, you got to respect 50 for that. I did. I mean, because he knew that any controversy that any dust that he kicked up, it was going to pay dividends for him. But What Up Gangsta is a tough, tough song. But I like that joint. Bangs in the club too. I heard it played a lot in the club that particular weekend, All-Star weekend. track 3, Patiently Waiting, featuring Eminem, which is also produced by Eminem. Typical back and forth between 50 and Eminem. Eminem, I like he said, Shady Records was 80 seconds away from the towers, meaning the World Trade Center. He said they fucked with the wrong ones. They meant to hit ours, meaning that the terrorists from 9/11 was trying to hit the Shady Records building instead of the World Trade Center. Clever line. Not true, but clever nonetheless. But I mean, it's vintage Eminem, because you know, y'all know, when Eminem gets on a track, Eminem's already a really, really good rapper. When he gets on a track with somebody, he tries to body you. And, you know, he did his best to try to body 50. They, you know, 50 held his own. Then we get into track 4, Many Men, Wish Death. This song actually starts with an intro of 50 being shot. And I think I don't know if he did that on purpose, but if you listen to that particular intro when the song comes on, it sounds similar to how the people would have sounded, the ones that came at 50 that actually shot him. 50 never acknowledged. I don't know if he gives reference to someone who shot him, saying that he knew who shot him, and he said that that person got killed too. So I don't know if that's true or not. Track 5, In the Club, banger. I mean, go shorty, it's your birthday, we're gonna party like it's your birthday. That song still, I mean, on everybody's birthday they play that song. So another Dr. Dre banger. The first time that I heard it, I was like, oh hell yeah, that would have been on Detox. Track 6, High All the Time. That was good. Another solid song. So, I mean, like, 50's out the gate. First 6 songs out the gate are nice. Then we get to track 7, which is my personal favorite on the album. It's called Heat, produced by Dr. Dre. The drums, I don't even know if you want to call it a snare, and a gunshot, man, and a synthesizer. It is crazy. That beat is crazy. I love it. I love it. 50 goes off on this one. Again, talking trash like 50 does. But again, my favorite track on the album. Then he gets into track 8, If I Can't. Another track produced by Dr. Dre. Another banger. Track 9, Bloodhound, featuring Young Buck. This was produced by Sean Blaze. It was interesting to have the Young Buck on this one. I was okay with this one. Even back then it was solid, but it didn't blow me away. But it was a solid track. Then we get to track 10, Back Down, produced by Dr. Dre. Back Down was a song that 50 takes direct aim at Ja Rule. And again, you can make the case, and many have made the case, that this was the beginning of the end for Ja. Because 50 literally, you know, just used a couple of bars and he went right at Ja. And, you know, again, you can make the case that Ja hadn't been the same, you know, collectively as an artist since then. Because people stopped rocking with Ja Rule. Then we get to the ever popular track 11, PIMP, produced by Mr. Porter. I mean, radio friendly joint, still smoker to this day. Track 12 was produced by The Rockwilder, Like My Style, featuring Tony Yayo. I ain't really like this one. I think he could have left this one at home. I mean, but you know, he had Young Buck on one track, Tony Yayo. Of course, those guys are part of the G-Unit crew. It was Young Buck, Tony Yayo, and a little guy by the name of the game. Who's the other guy? Lloyd Banks. That was G-Unit crew. And you know, 50 and his G-Unit crew had a nice little run. I mean, say what you want about them, they had a nice little run after this album. Track 13, Poor Little Rich. produced by Sha Money and Eminem. I like this. I like it. Some people that I know didn't like this, but I like this. It's so smooth. It can go. Then track 14, 21 questions, the radio friendly joint that was produced by Dirty Swift. This featured the late, great Nate D-O-double-G. I mean, he said, I love you like a fat kid loves cake. Yeah, I mean, you can't lose with Nate Dogg on a hook. I mean, you would be hard pressed to find a track with Nate Dogg on the hook that wasn't good. I mean, rest in peace, man. Nate didn't miss. The next track was track 15, Don't Push Me, featuring Lloyd Banks and Eminem, produced by Eminem. It's okay. No, nothing. Nobody blew me away on this one. And then the last track was produced by Megahertz, track 16, Gotta Make It to Heaven. It was okay too. I'm not blown away, but the first, I'll put it like this, as an old school, remember the A side and B side? A side, A much, much stronger than side B, but that does not mean that side B isn't good, because I think it's a very solid album all the way through. I would say under the Source rating, from 5 mic to 1 mic, 5 being the highest, obviously, 5 being a classic, I'd say this is a, I would say that this is a 4 mic album. If you said 3.5, I give it. If you said 4.5, I give it. I can't give it a class. It's not a classic, no. But I think it's somewhere between 3.5 and 4 mics. Very, very good album. Very easy to listen to. Still, I mean, like, the production, bangers. I mean, like, I put this on in the car and it was just, I just let it roll. And it was funny because, like, I remember how much I played this album, because without even looking at the track listing, I knew what with the next, when one song ended, I knew what was coming on next. And it's because I played the album so much. Again, man, 50, he came out of the gate smoking, and you realize pretty quickly that the guy knew what he was doing. He could rap, but he was a hustler and he was a businessman. And I mean, that you can see how that has transitioned him into what he's doing now. I think this is the best album in his discography. I don't know if we'll ever get another 50 Cent album. But to be honest, I don't necessarily know that we need one, if we're being honest. But that being said, this album, if you were around in 2003, you know the impact that this album had. This album literally was everywhere. The videos were on MTV and BET. The songs were on the radio. The songs were everywhere. I mean, black radio, white radio. And, you know, it established 50 Cent as a major player in the game. And, you know, I don't think anybody can argue with the success that he's had. And it all got started right here. February 6th, 2003, with Get Rich or Die Trying. Hey, ladies and gentlemen, that's going to do it for me. Thank you for checking out this edition of the 12 Kyle Podcast. Remember to subscribe to the podcast. The podcast drops every Thursday at midnight. From time to time, we'll drop episodes like this one on Sundays. These bonus episodes get dropped on Sundays at midnight. And a new twist I would like to add. I heard my man Uncle Dolomite say this, and I'm going to add this to my podcast as well. If you like to support the 12 Kyle Podcast, feel free to hit us up on Cash App. 12 Kyle, spelled out T-W-E-L-V-E-K-Y-L-E. That's going to do it for me. Ladies and gentlemen, I am your boy 12 Kyle. I'll catch you guys next time. 5 G's.